Hello, and welcome to a very special episode of The Gamer's Experience, where we usually talk about my favorite top 100 PC games in chronological order. I share stories, and I share gameplay footage with you. However, today is a little different. Today, we're going to take a little bit of a sidetrack. We're going to do a side quest. That's even better. And we're going to talk about Culdcept. Yeah, Culdcept. And every time I bring that up with my friends, they're like, what the heck is Culdcept? I've never heard of Culdcept before. Well, it's not a PC game, so that's why it's not in my main series. And that's why this video will be set in a separate series on YouTube if you're looking for it. Nope. Culdcept is actually, well, I first played it on the PlayStation 2. It's a console game, and there's a lot of great console-exclusive games that that if you're not looking into some of these, you're missing out on some really great original experiences. So, Culdcept is one of those experiences. And it's not just console exclusive, but it's also something that not a whole lot of people have heard of. And the reason why I wanted to bring it up today and share this video with you is that it was recently announced that there's going to be a new Culdcept game coming out soon for the Nintendo 3DS system. And as I'm telling my friends, oh, okay, have you pre-ordered Culdcept Revolt for the 3DS? They're like, what is Culdcept? So, next time a friend asks me that, I'm going to show them this video here. Whoops, made my picture a little too small there. Hey, there I am. It's hiding in a corner there. We were looking mostly at my Horizon Zero Dawn wallpaper. Super, super fun game, by the way, Horizon Zero Dawn. But today, we're here to talk about Culdcept. So, for those of you who do not know, Culdcept is a turn-based strategy video game. It's a board game. We'll call it what it is. Technically, somewhere in the back of the manual says it's a turn-based strategy video game. That's how they classify it on the store shelves. But you can think of Culdcept as a great marriage between Magic the Gathering and Monopoly. It is really a lot of fun. It was originally released in North America. On December 4th, 2003 on the PlayStation 2. And there were early iterations in Japan on the Saturn, the original PlayStation. We did later on get another game here, and I'll show you a couple little screensies here. So this is the PlayStation 2 cover. Oops, my face is in the way again. We'll just shrink that there. And you can kind of see that there's a blind lady there of some sort, a goddess. With a whole bunch of cards that she has coming out of her. And then we got some text on the back here. It says, Culdcept, the book of creation and destruction made by the absolute goddess Culdra. Those who control the power can acquire the power of God. Scepters, individuals with the capability to summon from within the book, fight for total control over Culdcept. Those who control the book become gods, and many worlds were created or destroyed by those who took over the power. But Culdra is foreseeing the future. There would be one scepter who will stop this chain and use the power to destroy the entire universe. Now the fight for the fate of the universe is about to begin. Wahahaha. And there's some very small little screenshots in the back of there, but this is what the box looked like back in the day. Later on, they did release a 360 game called Culdcept Sega. Which, I love Culdcept so much, I almost got an Xbox 360 for this game alone. I didn't, and I still kind of feel like I missed out a little bit. But thankfully, we're going to get a new game on the 3DS, which I do happen to have. But Culdcept allows you to collect a whole bunch of cards that are very similar to Magic the Gathering, and we're going to see some of them in the gameplay footage. You create a deck of 50 cards, but instead of just going back and forth card game-wise, you're actually going to be playing a Monopoly board where you'll be playing cards to take over lands. And it's one of those things that's best shown rather than just described. But as I mentioned, the reason why I'm doing this video is I want to get people hyped for Culdcept Revolt, which is coming out on the Nintendo 3DS. You can pre-order it through Amazon, or you can get it through the Nintendo eShop. And it's coming out in the summer of 2017. They've got a website up, and you might want to go in and check it out. If you got a PlayStation 2 or you got an Xbox 360, you can also purchase these games on eBay and the such. So when I looked them up before, they weren't too expensive. But they're super, super fun and very original. As a game collector, when I'm looking over games, I'm really looking not only for games that really raise the bar and tell a really great story or execute graphics really well or of course gameplay, but I'm looking for original games as well. And Culdcept, while not a perfect game, is pretty darn original. There's nothing else I've played quite like Culdcept. And you're about to come with me on that journey. We're gonna check this out together as I get a game booted up for you. So give me just 1 second. And I have returned, and I know you guys are wondering, Phil, where is your co-host? Well, here she is. You can see her little thumbnail down there. I'll blow it up a little bit. But here is co-host Minu. Hi guys, how you doing? See there? You know, a good co-host doesn't upstage you, just kind of let you shine. That's what Minu does. So I'll just put her back there as we get ready to play some Culdcept from the PlayStation 2. So we'll go ahead and shrink this guy back here, and we'll see if we can't pop that video game footage up for you here in a second. But yeah, Culdcept is super awesome. So I have taken the liberty. So the way the single player game, you can play this with other people, which is super fun in a party setting. Or you can play this. You can play this solo against the computer, which I do a lot of in the such. And for the most part, it's done really well. Scooch over a little second here. There's a campaign, and as you go through the campaign, you unlock more cards, which is something that's sorely missing from a lot of card-based games. They need a single-player campaign that lets you kind of unlock cards as you go along, and you learn the game here. I've already played a couple of boards, and I've just unlocked some new cards. So a deck of cards is called a book, as you kind of see here. And I'm gonna shrink my pictures a little bit further and sneak it off into the corner here so you can see some more. But if you open up a book here, you can edit it, you can copy your book and the such. But these are all the cards. And the most of your cards are going to be your monster cards. And if you click on them, you get the statistics here. And hopefully you can see my mouse here, but we've got our strength, his attack strength, hit points. Nothing unusual to those people who play Magic the Gathering. How much magic or gold or whatever you want to call it he costs to cast is right there. And we have different types of monsters, and just like Magic the Gathering, some of them have some special abilities. Like our lion friend here, the Chimera, has a first attack. Plus, every time you hit a lap, you hit go, essentially, he gets an extra 10 strength, up to a maximum of 80. So that's pretty cool. You'll notice that some of these monsters have red borders, green borders. These are the different elements. There's also yellow and blue. I just don't tend to carry them in my deck right now. And then you have item cards. And item cards can be used in battle to give your monsters extra hit points, or in the case of weapons, they'll give them extra attack. You've got cards that allow you to like move a certain number of spaces or roll two dice instead of one. So you'll find those in there. Just like Magic the Gathering, you got spells that do special things, like the spell Shatter destroys an enemy card that's out of his hand that isn't a creature card. So there's some strategy in building your deck and how well you bounce out, just like Magic the Gathering. You'll definitely, try to figure out what kind of deck you want to put together. Every time you complete a board in the single player mode, you unlock some new cards, and it does a really great job of showing you what the new cards are right here. I've already kind of taken a glance through these. But there is, for example, if I wanted to equip this one in my deck, I just have to change the 0 to a 1 by pressing right on the controller, and now that one's included in my deck. So it's pretty cool. This little guy here neutralizes all attacks, so that could be useful, for example. But yeah, if you can mouse over any of these guys and it'll tell you what it is. But there's a lot of cards, and playing through the campaign allows you to learn the cards slowly instead of being inundated with hundreds of cards all at once. Now, decks are supposed to have 50 cards, so if they go over, it won't really let you save. So I'll need to take out a card since I've added a card. And so all I have to do is just kind of go to one of these. I think I'll take the healing card, and I'll just get rid of him. So no more healing cards. So there we go. Got a 50 deck. You can hit escape, apply those changes, and boom, we have our deck there. Let's see here. You can kind of hear the music back there. It's pretty cool. It's very soothing. Hopefully it's not overpowering there. Kind of like the background music too. It's kind of soothing background, kind of background music there. So normally when I show you guys these games, I usually start off at the very beginning, but I'm just kind of jumping right into it. There's a little bit of animation, story at the beginning, whatever. It really, it's just, as you can tell by reading the back of the cartridge, it's not really that important. It's not even close to being the focus of the game. Jumping in with gameplay is the focus of the game here. So we've got our book already. We're going to jump right into it because I know your time is valuable. So there's this world map that you're going to move your character to play, you know, different battles against people. And I've already done these two already, so I'm going to move on to the next one here. And there's going to be some text here. We're going to skip over the text. This story here is really not important. What is important here is it gives you a preview of the map. Now, one of the cool things about Culdcept is it's a board game, but it's a board game in a video game, right? So they can do lots of different things. In Monopoly, you play the same square board all of the time. In Culdcept, it's a video game. So they can program multiple boards with multiple configurations, and this has an impact, you know, on the strategy that you're going to play here. So this board is going to look different than, let's say, the very beginning board. If we go over to here, you'll see here, it's just a square, very, very plain board. But the boards get more and more intricate as you go on, and they force you to make some choices, which is pretty cool. So we'll go ahead and enter here. Now, the goal here is to make 6,000 gold. Unlike Monopoly, where your goal is simply to bankrupt the other people, and that still does kind of work here, generally speaking, it's just to get up to a certain wealth value first. In this case, 6,000. So, got some FMV here. Ooh, a big castle. Nobody cares. Let's play. So, got some storyline here. I'm just gonna zip past it. Gonna just want to get to the fight. Oh, hey, or I can hit start and just skip past it. There we go. So I'm playing against one other opponent in this one, named Selena. My character is named Abby, and he's giving us a little tutorial here, telling us that there's a space on here that'll let us... there's a space on here that'll let us pull the card that we want. So at the beginning of your turn, just like Magic the Gathering, you pull a card here. I'm gonna turn down the music so you can hear me better. And I've got Pillar of Flame, which a fire creature with really good health at 50, but cannot be used offensively. So I got 5 cards in my hand, one is which a spell. And if I press up, I go to rolling a dice. If I press down instead, I go to different options. And you'll see me use these as the game goes on. For now, we're just going to jump right into it. Making note that I do have 3 fire cards in my hand, and that's kind of important. See, at the beginning, you get to pick which direction you want to go, unlike Monopoly. Since I got a fire card in my hand, I'm going to go to a fire land. Because when you put a fire creature on a fire land, he gets additional health. And whatnot. So, we're going to go ahead and stick our fire wall here. And Selena's going to take her turn. The computer moves pretty fast, but gives you enough time to kind of read what's going on. She is taking a fire square. So very much like Monopoly, you want to try to own multiple of the same color. Now the 20 that's on here is how much rent she'll pay, essentially, if she lands on this and fails to attack me. So if I land on her square, I have to pay 20. But the more of these you have, the more the rent goes up. So that's something to kind of keep in mind. So I've got another fire land here. I rolled a 2, which is very lucky, because now I can take this square as well. Oh, let's stick him down here. Well, we got him, and we got... Oh, we like Chimera better.
So now I've got two lands, and now the rent has gone up to 30, as you can see on both of those. Another cool thing about... Oh, she's going to silence me so I can't cast creature spells for the next couple of rounds. But another cool thing about the computer doing everything is it does all the math for you. Whatever rules are running, the numbers underneath the hood, it's doing all the hard work. So I've got a card here that'll let me destroy one of her item cards. So I'm just going to go ahead and use that because I see she has three item cards here. Uh-huh. Okay. Every time you pass one of these checkpoints, you get some extra gold, which is very helpful. I can't cast more creatures, so I can't take this land even if I wanted to. Now, my deck mostly has grass and fire creatures. Which I can't. I just remembered. I'm still silent, so I can't take that grassland even if I wanted to. Evil silence spell. We'll get back at her. So we got a sword, which we can use to on an offensive attack, which will probably come up here soon, maybe. I don't really want this waterland, so I'm just gonna pass it up. We're just kind of zipping through this because this game, just like Monopoly, it can take some time. So I want to make sure that that I'm not wasting too much of your time here. This magic bolt will do 20 damage to a target enemy creature. And so every creature has so many hit points, including his little fuzzy creature right here. And we can zap that creature just like that. And the little squirrel guy will probably die. Haha. And that means he no longer owns that land. See, unlike Monopoly in this game, in order to own a land, you basically got to keep a monster on it. And then whenever you walk by one of your lands, or you land on start the castle like I just did, it gives you an opportunity to basically upgrade those lands or move creatures around or whatever. So I like my creatures to be kind of close together on one hand, but I also like to upgrade my squares. So I'm going to level this guy up. And you can spend 100 gold or 300 gold. As you can see right here, I have 560 gold to spend. My total value is 860. The goal is to get to 6,000. So I can level him up. Like so. And now if Selena there happens to land on him, she could be paying a lot of money. She's drawing some extra cards there, which seems to be a bit of a waste, because she's already got a full hand. AI's not the smartest thing in the world sometimes. Turn up this so a little bit so you can hear it. Another red creature. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I got a 6 card. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That doesn't really help me a whole lot. Ah, I didn't mean to do that. Level him up too. Now, you probably have noticed that when you cross the center square, you have the chance to just keep looping around if you want, or you can go down to the other half. And you're saying, well, Phil, maybe I just don't ever want to go to the other side. I just want to stay on one side for selfish reasons or whatever have you. You can do that, but you'll notice there's an N and an S up here that light up. These are the north and south towers. So the north tower's up here, the south tower's way at the bottom. In order for me to get the bonus for passing by the castle, the gold you get by doing a full lap, you have to touch both of those guys. So that's something to keep in mind. Of course, now I roll a 1. Meant to go the other way so I could get more red lands. Let me see, I got a lot of cards here. We'll get rid of this guy here. Alright, that's a good number to get. Gets me back to go here. We're gonna let him upgrade. The real fun begins when we start landing on each other's squares and having to pay each other money. So, I know it seems a little slow. It starts out a little bit slow. So does regular Monopoly. That's a thing. Got two of these guys. I can really use some grasslands here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I'll get me all the way around here. I think I'll go ahead and upgrade my lion guy one more time. Just like a Monopoly, I kind of like to push my luck on upgrading lands and hope for some big rent. So she's forcing me to move three squares. So one of the cool things in this game is you can play a card to force the other guy to move a certain number of squares, which is really great when they're exactly X number of squares away from your land. And in fact, oh, I threw away my six. Could have used it right there. Put a little green creature right there. I can do green too. Just giving ourselves some extra money there. Woohoo. Ah. Roll a one or a three next time. Pay me some rent. Just taking over my fire squares. I don't like her taking over my fire squares. Now, one of the cool things, we're going to show you a little trick right here. My line levels up again. So, whenever you pass up one of your squares, as I mentioned before, you can upgrade them. And if you land on the castle like I just did, you can upgrade any one of the squares that you own. But there's another command you can use as well, and that's to move your creature. So, let me just make sure I'm kind of in the ballpark here. So, I can use this creature to attack this creature, for example. I'm probably going to lose, but let's just show you what that looks like. So we take him, and we say, hey, I want to move this creature. I want to move him over here. And he'll attack him. And if I win, I get that square and knock her off that board there. Now, this screen shows you kind of what's going to happen here. My creature has 30 strength and 40 defense, and his creature has 30 strength and 40 defense. So when 30 strength hits 40 hit points, it leaves 10 left over, his creature survives. He will do the same thing to mine. Both of our creatures will be hurt a lot, but will both survive. Now, one of the things you can do, though, to help turn the tide into your favor is to use different items. I have something that gives me more health and some swords that can give me more attack strength. One of the cool things about this game is you never know what your enemy is going to do ahead of time, right? You kind of see what the current status is. But you don't know if they're going to use one of their items or not. Items are kind of rare, so there's a little bit of a mind game going on there. If I attack a square, you know, should I use a weapon? Should they use an armor? I don't know. So there's a little bit of poker thing. It's really fun when you got friends in the same room and they're about to pay, you know, some rent. And the question is, well, are they going to use their one item? You can see what they have because it's all on the same screen, but you don't know if they're going to use it or not. So I'm going to use a sword here, which will add 30 to my attack, making his attack power 60. By the way, because that's a grass creature on a grass land, you'll see here that normally its hit points are 30, but it gets 10 more because it's on a grass land for a total of 40. The more you level up that grassland, the better that effect gets. So the game gives you bonuses for putting, you know, grass creatures on grasslands, fire creatures on fire lands, and the such. So I'm going to use a sword here. Now, the computer's going to decide whether it's going to use an item to help itself out, and it is. So, I try to kill it, but I'm going to fail. And I cause it to feel confusion, which I think actually means it hurts itself, which is pretty funny. So we've actually both died in that. So we both lost ownership of our lands. So that's pretty funny. But as you can see, there can be some strategy in there. A lot better than Monopoly. Oh, look, she laid on my rent square. Huh? And she didn't have any creatures to defend herself, so she had to pay rent. Which brings up another point. When you land on someone's square, you don't have to pay rent. If you have a monster card in your hand, you might get fortunate enough and be able to fight them for it. Now, if she rolls a 2, I'm going to crap a brick, because that would be some juicy rent. She's got a bunch of weapons and items in her hands, but she's pretty short on creatures. So that's a problem for her. Gets me some extra money there. And I put this Minotaur here. I like having lands in a row. So I'm going to see if I can take over her little priest creature right here. Ooh. That could be a little tough, but I think we should be able to win that one. So I happen to remember I didn't see any armor cards in her hand or any extra creature cards in her hand. So I think I would win that. There's also these scroll cards, which does 30 points of damage automatically, so I could try that too, but we'll just hit buttons and see what happens here. Oh, so she's going to use a spear that's going to give her more attack. Oh, and more health, but not enough to defend against the Minotaur's axe there. My Minotaur got extra attack power because that square is right next to one of my other creatures, so he gets support from the guy next to him. Oh my gosh, she's going back around the fire square again. I might have mentioned that the AI sometimes does silly things. Oh, she needs to pass North Square anyways. It's not usually super, super dumb. She does have to cover both the North and South Square at some point anyways. So she really didn't have much of a choice. Ooh, a green creature. I'll keep him. Got a couple of attack weapons. So, we're not making a whole lot of space here. A whole lot of movement.
Holy word, 6.
Yeah, she used a 6 card so she would make sure she wouldn't roll a 1 to land on my line. So, see, she wasn't too stupid. Gonna purposely attack. Oh, so I thought I was gonna attack her with my grass creature here, but on the cost count it says 70 plus green. I already have to own a green square in order to be able to play him, so I can try attacking with my fighter. Who the little signs here help give you some advice. The equal sign says that, you know, he's got enough power just to take her out, whereas the downside says no, he doesn't have enough attack power. So, we'll just give it a shot here. I could use one of my items to help buff him up, but I'm not that invested in trying to get this square, so I'm going to hold on to my items. But again, if I'm playing with somebody, they don't know. I do have some items I could use, and that's part of the fun, is just trying to psych the other person out. Well, apparently he didn't use any defense items, so... And the attacker gets the first attack, so even though... You know, we probably would have killed each other if we both hit at the same time. The attacker gets the first attack, unless the card says otherwise. Some cards say first attack on defense.
Money.
That's that money card. Free money! Now that I own a grassland, I can go ahead and play this creature. He's more an offense creature because he has higher attack than defense, but he's the only grass creature I have at the moment. I forget what happens if you run out of cards. It's probably in the rules somewhere. Which, by the way, so I'll show you. But down here, under help, it's going to give you some general directions, but you can read the manual. The whole entire manual is right here. For some odd reason, you don't have the printed manual. So I'm sure if I looked about what happens if you run out of cards, I would find it in there. We're just getting a lot of grass squares now. Oh, so she's gonna land on one of my creatures here. And she's gonna attack. And she does have some items to help her out. So the question is whether or not I want to use something, just in case, because her attack is only 20. My hit points are 40, but if she uses an item that gives her 20 more attacks, she'll get the first attack and win. So I can use this chest armor here, but I'll probably hold on to it for something more important. Oh, that looks painful. Ouch. Oh, yeah, I get to pick a card out of my book. Well, that wasn't much. I'm going to turn up the volume so you can hear what happens when they get into a fight, especially.
Good luck to your next journey.
I like the announcer.
Discard your card. You've got a reward.
Hey, a reward.
Good luck to your next journey.
So, I've already done the north and the south. I'm gonna go south because I can get this green spirit right here, and I gotta go south anyways at some point. So, that's where that decision of which way you wanna go can help you out there. Ah, she passed up all my different spots. Okay, so listen to this thing here. It's pretty funny. So play this creature here.
Dragonfly, kobold.
It's like dragonfly versus kobold. So I just took that land from her. I need to start raising up these grasslands so that they're actually worth some decent rent. I'm going to go ahead and play a 1 here just to allow me... no, I won't. Wait. No, I won't. I'm going to save. I'm going to hold on to that. Oh, I get to upgrade any territory I want to anyways. So, this is a fire creature on a grassland. Upgrading this land wouldn't be super wise because my creature isn't going to get any additional benefit. That one can be upgraded. This one can be upgraded. You know, they're all pretty good. But this one has the highest defense hit point wise. So, he's a good candidate for upgrading. She's upgrading that fire guy. Good for her. Now I can upgrade. That's a neutral guy. Now if I have let me see what's in my hand here. Let's see what's in my hand. Shoot, I don't have any grass creatures. If I had a grass creature, I could swap out that warrior. You can swap out. You can exchange a creature when you have access to upgrade territories and the such. So I'm gonna upgrade one of my fire guys again. Yeah, that's a big ruined spot now. So it's just a little rent spot there. She's gonna fight for it. And she'd have to use an item to win it. And it's not really upgraded, so I'm not gonna use an item. That carbuncle has the support ability, which allows it basically for her to burn another monster card in her hand and add its attack strength to her attack strength. So yeah, she won that one. Oh, now I get a grass creature in my hand. We'll hold on to him, because might need him later on. Oh, she comes up here to pay some rent. Doing that silence card again, so I won't be able to cast any monsters for a few turns. Very rude. Okay, she's coming around to my block. I like the fact she's coming to my block. Lots of cards. I don't know, it's a tough one. I'll get rid of this guy. Ah. So you can build a deck with a lot of different colors, so you can take up more lands. I like to focus on like two, maybe three tops. What's she doing? Shrink? Basically lowered his stats. That went a little too fast for my taste. I didn't see exactly what he lost there. Get rid of anything. It's all good. You got a reward. Good luck to your next journey. Now I'm going to purposely land on her square because I want to see if I can take it over. I have the advantage of the two surrounding squares having my creatures on them, which will give me an attack bonus. I'll turn up the volume here.
Gas cloud, woodfolk.
Ah, she has a whoa, oh crap. Ah. Well,
the battle was.
I ended up paying some rent for that one. You got more cards.
Aim for the next
floor. Oh yeah, land on daddy's square. Oh, I just got really rich. That was awesome. So remember, I think the goal is to make 6,000. She just gave me 900 more towards that end. So I'm now up to 5,554, because she landed on the money spot there and could not fight her way out of it.
Aim for the next port.
So I'm exchanging this guy with a grass dude here. This one's a really good defense card. So now it makes more sense for me to upgrade that land, because I've got a grass dude that will receive extra hit points from a grass land. I don't know why she threed me for. We might win this. I mean, when you pass go, you get money. And, let's see here. So I'm about to hit 6,000, so I'll level up this to... Oh, I'll level him up big. Okay, so now I'll win the next time I hit go. My number's flashing.
Holy word.
I think he also had to have hit both towers, and I've only hit one tower on this lap, so... She's probably gonna land on one of my squares. Okay, so this is sweet. I've been holding on, if you're paying attention, you probably noticed I've held on to this one card for a while here. And, what I'm gonna do here is I'm not gonna use this on her. That's gonna force her to move one square on her next turn, which will put her right on top of my very expensive... rock land there. Yeah, enjoy that ride. And when you're doing that with friends over a couple of beers, yeah, it's super fun. At least until she beats the square, but nope. So, the number briefly flashed on there, but now she's in the negative, so she has to start selling lands, just like Monopoly. And if she couldn't sell anything left, she'd be completely out of the game. So, I'm either going to win if she goes broke, or if I can make it back to the castle, because I've now got the 6,000 needed to win here.
Good luck to your next journey.
Yeah, she'd be wise to stay away from the northern half of the screen. And the artwork on the cards is pretty nice too. Just very well done all the way around. Different artists, different styles. It's very nice. I like the Broken Warrior dude here. Oh, come on. A one, of course. But you get a pretty good gist of the game there. I'll win this here, I'll win some more cards. But it's super fun. It's super fun to work through, work up your deck, get better cards. And the game can be a little slow when there's lots of opponents and they're all doing their thing. So, admittedly, you know, when you're playing with other people, it's a lot of fun. When you're playing against a computer, admittedly, it can be a little slow in between turns. So it's a good game to play if you're watching YouTube or something along those lines. Boom. There we go. Now we'll win here. Turn it up.
You are the winner of this war. The true winner is determined.
And then here we go. We got some new cards, and you know, you want to read through these. A scroll attack ignores the bonus hit points they get for being on that same land. So if a scroll attack with a 40 strength hits a creature that normally has 40 strength with no land bonuses, it's going to kill him outright. And it does critical damage to creatures with 20 strength or less. So there's different reasons to use each of these cards. But you get to read through them. And then you can decide which ones you wanna, you know, add to your hand. So this one, I'm glad I read this card. So this one says Territory 80. And what that means is, you might remember, every time I passed it one of my creatures or I hit the castle, I could use what was basically the territory command on any affected square that I owned. Usually you would use that to upgrade or move a creature over space or even swap the creature out with another one in your hand. What this one allows you to do is it'll summon a Baal to a selected vacant land, and then this creature, the conjurer, will self-destruct. He gives up his life to summon Baal. So that looks pretty funny. That looks like a winner right there. I'll have to add that to the deck just to see what the hell happens. And this is one of my favorite grass cards. So 20-40, not super strong until you realize that if he's used on offense, he gets an extra 30. So that makes him great for taking over squares and holding on to them. Not too bad with the 40 hit points. So there you go. I mean, just there's a lot more to discover as you play through and you do different cards and stuff. There's all kinds of fun to be had there with Culdcept. So like I said, hopefully you got to see that, see one of the games that I love so much, and understand a little bit why I love it. And hopefully you're a little bit more excited now. You have a 3DS. A new 3DS or whatever the hell they're called. You can look forward to Culdcept Revolt with me coming in summer 2017. For those people who are fans of what I usually put out, I know the videos have been slow lately, been very busy. Lots of work, lots of college and those types of things. And this is just really a very much a side hobby of mine. So I do them when I can get to them. But hopefully you enjoyed this video and seeing one of my favorite games and sharing some of that passion with you. And let me know in the comments if you've ever played Culdcept before, if you liked it, you didn't like it, or if this is your first time viewing it, what are your thoughts after watching this video? Hopefully you saw some things in there that were very interesting. But this is one of the reasons why I collect console and console games, because there's a lot of a really awesome, some of them very, very original like this, games that you just don't get on the PC. Now we're starting to see a lot of those coming to the PC more and more. Maybe NIS will bring one of the Culdcept games to the PC in the not too distant future. We can only hope. Let them know if that's something you would like to see, you know, brought to the PC. But we are seeing some console exclusive series. Final Fantasy has been pouring all theirs out on Steam. We've got Disgaea games now recently popping on there. We're seeing a lot of the JRPGs just here and there cropping up on Steam and GOG. So, who knows? But in the meantime, Culdcept Revolt's coming out, and there's a lot of great games on the 3DS anyways. This would just be another good reason to get yourself a 3DS to play on the airplane or on your trip, or while you're just sitting in front of the television and relaxing, playing a little cards, Monopoly style, while you're watching something fun. I hope you enjoy this, and I hope you have a very great day, and we'll catch you on the next A Gamer's Experience.